Seeing our opening hymn from All Men Love Lovers, guys. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart. Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord.
Blessed are those who keep his testimonies, who seek him with their whole heart.
Who also do no wrong, but walk in his ways.
You have commanded your precepts to be kept diligently.
Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping your statutes.
That I shall not be put to shame, having fasted from all your commandments.
I will praise you with an upright heart when I learn your righteous rules.
I will keep your statutes, do not utterly forsake me.
God's word says, if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, by loving the Lord your God, by walking in his ways, and by keeping his commandments, and his statutes, and his rules, then you shall live. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 16. We confess our sins to God in sincere repentance. Glorious and gracious God,
we are sinners, sinful from birth, and yet so often disobeying your commands. And our hearts can be blessed with your grace, with our lips being at first in justice and faith. Our actions are not consistent with walking in your ways. Forgive us our sins, for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Jesus lived a perfect life and died a sacrificial death on the cross for us. For his sake, God forgives our sins. As a servant of Jesus, and in his stead, I therefore announce the forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thanks be to God. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who governs all things in heaven and earth,
mercifully hear the prayers of your people, and grant us your peace through all our days.
Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated for the Old Testament.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The Old Testament is coming from Genesis chapter 22, verses 1 through 18. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham, here I am," he replied. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire, and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father, "Abraham, father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told them about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar, on top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. Abraham looked up, and there in the thicket, he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day, it is said, "On the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided." The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me." This is the word of the Lord. The epistle reading is coming from 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 13. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship, that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always preserves. Love never fails, but where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in our part. But when completeness comes, when it is in part, disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me. For now, we see only a reflection as a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the gospel reading. The gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. While every branch that does not bear fruit, he prunes so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, and showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you can keep my commands, you will remain in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You're my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends. For everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord Christ.
Let's stand for the sermon beginning this morning.
Thank you.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you today, and God, we are so grateful for the love that was demonstrated on the cross through the perfect man, the holy man. God, you are worthy, as we sang this morning. You are worthy of all the praise. You are all worthy of all the honor. God, we are so grateful for you. We are so grateful for your love, the perfect love that was manifested on the cross. God, be with us this morning, God. May you speak through me, that I may decrease, that you may increase, Lord. And that you would speak a now message to each and every person in this room today. In your name we pray.
Amen.
You may be seated. So I have a confession to make. And, you know, it's not something that I'm really proud of. In fact, I've tried to keep it a secret for a long time. But I feel like Holy Cross is family. This is a safe space. You guys won't judge me too harshly. So I feel like now is an opportune time to admit it. And it's something that I kind of dabbled in before, but really kind of took a catalyst during, or really took off during the pandemic. Seth and I have a mild obsession with reality dating shows. We love it. We love it. It all started with the OG of dating shows, The Bachelor. And The Bachelor, if you've ever seen The Bachelor, you know that The Bachelor is an eligible bachelor who is on this journey or quest for love. And he is obviously a very eligible, very, very desirable bachelor. But for whatever reason, he has not been able to find true love. And so he goes on the show, and there are 35 women who are vying for the bachelor's love. And so they're in this secluded area or secluded house, and for however long the show is filmed, the bachelor is forming relationships with these different women, and every week there are dates, there's group dates, there's individual dates, but every week he's given a number of roses, and each week the number of roses gets smaller and smaller. And the roses symbolize the women that he wants to continue moving forward with, continues to want to build a relationship with. And it finally culminates in what is the final rose. And the final rose is the person that he's fallen in love with, wants to spend the rest of his life with. And the final rose is supposed to coincide with an engagement. You're supposed to get engaged at the final rose. But it's at the final rose ceremony. As you can imagine, 35 women vying for one eligible bachelor's heart, it lends itself to a lot of drama, there's a lot of crying, there's a lot of backstabbing. We love it. So the bachelor has since spun off, and they have the bachelorette. Same concept, but instead it is a woman candidate who is looking to find love with 35 eligible men. And it's same level of drama, same level of kind of backstabbing. It's actually a little bit more interesting when it's the bachelorette, because you don't expect men to be as petty as they are, but when you watch a bachelorette, it's pretty bad. They have since spun this off and done Bachelor in Paradise. Bachelor in Paradise takes the contestants from previous Bachelor and Bachelorette seasons, they put them on this remote resort in Mexico, and like it says, they are bachelors and bachelorettes in paradise. Each contestant gets their rose, and they're forming relationships. They're trying to figure out if there's any chemistry there. The twist here is that you start off with an equal number of men and women, but each week they're introducing new men and new women onto the island. So that lends itself to all this drama, because you have these relationships that have formed, and then you have men and women that are coming in that are interrupting these relationships. And it's like single summer camp. It's fascinating. And I didn't realize this, but they have since spun off Bachelor Nation into literally like every country. There's Bachelor in Australia, there's Bachelor United Kingdom, there's Bachelor, I think I saw like Bachelor Afghanistan. Like, it's crazy. But it's so fascinating. We've also, this is probably the one that I hate to admit, but we've actually watched this. The next one that we watched is Joe Millionaire. So Joe Millionaire is the same concept, but they have two contestants. They have a bachelor who is wealthy, and then there's a bachelor who's kind of just like an average Joe. And the women contestants don't know which one is the wealthy one and which one is the average Joe. And so the idea behind this is you're supposed to form relationships not because of a person's wealth, but because of who they are as a person. Obviously, a lot of drama there. The next one that we watched is Love is Blind. This one, this one's a recent addition. This one they have men and women in like in a resort, but the men are segregated on one side of the resort, the women are segregated on the other side. And they never meet the members of the opposite sex in person. The only time that they meet is in these pods where they can communicate with a shared wall, but they can't see each other, nor can they physically interact. And so the idea behind this is you're supposed to develop and cultivate relationships, not based on physical appearance or physical intimacy, but like actually getting to know people. What a foreign concept, right? So and the only time they're allowed to meet the other person is if they decide to get engaged. And so you are getting engaged to somebody who you have never physically met. You just know all this information about them. So, and then they have a month after they leave the pods to figure out if they want to actually get married or if they want to call it off. But this is a fascinating concept to me. The next one that we watch, this one takes the stakes even higher. Married at First Sight. Married at First Sight, these are men and women who were kind of just over the dating scene, generally. And so they said, you know what? We're not doing dating anymore. We're just gonna fill out these extensive questionnaires about our personal values and our morals and what we want in a spouse, and we're gonna leave it to the hands of experts, relationship experts. And these relationship experts take these surveys and they figure out what they deem to be a perfect match. And so the twist here is that you don't find out that you're getting married until 2 weeks before the wedding ceremony. And you don't meet your spouse, you know nothing about your future husband or wife until the altar. So like, they literally will walk up and they're introducing themselves like, hi, I'm Joe, hi, I'm Susie, at the altar. And so they have 10 weeks, so they get married, they do a normal reception, their families are getting to know each other, they go on a honeymoon with 4 to 5 other couples that have done the same married at first sight experiment from their city, and they go on a honeymoon, and they're still trying to figure out like who the other person is. And they have 10 weeks to figure out if they want to stay married or if they want to get a divorce. Now, the lawyer in me was like, there's no, like, it's one, like, marriage, yes, is holy matrimony, it's also a legally binding contract. And so the lawyer in me is like, there's no way they are legally married. And so I looked it up. They actually get married, but they just sign an ironclad prenup before they get married that says that all of your possessions are yours and all of my possessions are mine. So, but it is a legally binding contract. Now, all of these shows, as different as they are, have some similarities. The first is, you know, they're all carefully curated by the producers, right? I'm not naive enough to think that the producers aren't, like, don't have their hands in the mix. And although they're not quite scripted, they are orchestrated by the producers. I know that, right? I know that they're asking probing questions during the interviews. I know that they're probably showing other contestants on the show, like footage of the interviews to try to create drama. I get it. And still I watch it. I love it. Don't judge me. It's really fascinating. The second thing that I realize is that these aren't like normal people. They like, you watch The Bachelor. Let's take The Bachelor, for instance. Every bachelor has been like this model-looking guy with a perfectly chiseled body, like six-pack. He's got perfectly coiffed hair, curly white teeth. Like, they're not going to Costco on a Saturday and recruiting the guy with the dad bod and the receding hairline to be the bachelor. Like, these guys, they have no problem finding, going on dates. Like, they're good looking. And the contestants themselves, too. Like, they're all lounging around this house, like, hair and makeup perfectly done. They're just sitting on the couch in ballroom gowns. Like, that's not real life. That's not reality. And yet, we still watch it. The other point that I want to make is, if you are interested in finding true, lasting love and having a successful relationship, these shows aren't the way to go about it. And I found this. I found this chart. So I don't know the scientific methodology behind these statistics, but if you look at this chart, going on one of these reality dating shows isn't the way to like end up in a lasting, successful relationship. Right? 90-day fiance is probably the one with the highest. 75% of couples that started on the show are still together. I mean, I don't watch 90-day fiance, so I don't know how true that is. But look, Married at First Sight, 30%. The Bachelorette, 29%. The Bachelor is 4%. Too Hot to Handle, which is another show that Steph and I watch, 0%. The four couples that were together, they're no longer together. Like, if you want a lasting relationship, these shows aren't how you go about it. And knowing all these things, knowing that these shows are carefully orchestrated by the producers, knowing that these aren't real people, knowing that they have high failure rates, knowing all this, we still watch it. And when I say we, I mean not just Steph and I mean the collective we. The reason why there is The Bachelor in Afghanistan is because people watch it. Like, we're drawn to these type of shows. The reason we watch Nicholas Sparks books and read Nicholas Sparks books and watch Nicholas Sparks movies or Hallmark movies is because we are drawn to this idea of love. We desire love. We love love as a society. We love to see people falling in love. We love to think about the butterflies when relationships start. We love love. And on the Sunday before Valentine's Day, fellas, that was your reminder, Valentine's Day is Tuesday. On the Sunday before Valentine's Day, I'm here to tell you that perfect love does exist, but it exists not in the form of a rose. It exists in the form of a cross. Perfect love was manifested in this world in the form of a cross. And you and I are beneficiaries of and participants in the greatest love story ever told. You and I know love because Christ first loved us. Our gospel reading says, greater love has no other than one man would lay down his life for another, for a friend. You and I are friends of Christ. So you and I are part of that love story. We're reminded of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have eternal life. We know love. And the Bible also says we love because he first loved us. So this morning, I want to unpack some of the realities of the perfect love that was demonstrated on the cross for us. And the first is, perfect love requires action. Perfect love is a call to action. You see, we as society have made love to be this kind of euphoric feeling, right? It's the butterflies in the stomach. It's the walking on cloud nine. That's what we think of when we think of love. But true love requires action. Love is an action. It requires us saying, I'm going to give of myself for somebody else. It requires action. So much so that when John 3:16 says, for God so loved that he what? He gave. His love, his soul love for us was a call to an act, to action for him to give. And so this morning, as we think about love and as we think about God's perfect love, we need to remember that love is really a call to action. We're reminded of when Peter meets the risen Savior. After Peter has denied knowing Jesus three times, Jesus asks Peter what? He says, Peter, do you love me? And when he asks the question, he uses the phrase agape, with agape meaning like a perfect love, an unconditional love, a divine love. He says, Peter, do you agape me? Peter responds by saying, yes, Lord, I phileo love you. Phileo, the root word of Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love. He says, yes, I love you with the love of a brother. I love you. It's an affectionate love. So Peter responds to Jesus' question of, do you love me unconditionally? With, yes, I love you like a brother. And Jesus asks that question three times. And the fact that he asks the question three times is not on accident. Because how many times did Peter deny knowing Jesus? Three times. And so it's this idea that for the times that you deny knowing me, I'm going to restore you. I'm going to ask you and recenter your focus not on your denying me, but on your love for me. And so in response, every time Jesus asks, do you love me? And Peter replies, yes, I love you. I feel love you. What does Jesus say? Feed my sheep. Tend to my flock. Take care of my sheep. What is Jesus saying? Jesus is saying, when you respond to my perfect love with your love, it is a call to action. The way that you demonstrate your love for me in response to the love that I've demonstrated you is to take care of one another. He's saying love requires action. Love requires that you care for one another, that you love one another, that you act upon that love, that you tend to the sheep. And who are the sheep? It's you and I. It's a call to love one another. And it's a reminder that the only response that we have to God's perfect love, his unconditional love, is to love him and to love one another. And that's what our gospel message said. The greatest commandment is this, to love one another as I have loved you. So we are called, love is an action verb. It is not this euphoric feeling. It is not this kind of Hallmark card feeling. It requires action. The second point is love is enduring. Love is enduring. True love lasts. It's not just this fleeting feeling. One of the reasons why these reality TV shows have such a high failure rate is because it's really a superficial kind of love, right? When you think of The Bachelor, it's not hard to fall in love when you're in this secluded mansion. You don't have your phone, you're not working, you're not connected to anybody else. All you're thinking about is this relationship that you're forming. You're going on these exotic trips. You're going on once-in-a-lifetime dates. Like, no exaggeration, one of the dates in The Last Bachelor, last week actually, or on Monday, they went skydiving. Then they got back from skydiving. He's in a suit. She's in a dress, in like this ballroom dress. They go on this private terrace outside and are eating this like fine dining. They go to the courtyard and they're dancing under the stars and being serenaded by a live, like, singer who is singing to just them, and they're dancing, and like, it's not hard to fall in love in that situation. It's also not hard to fall in love in 3 months in that situation. But the reality is that those love stories are purely superficial. True love is called to endure the morning breath and the bedhead. It's called to endure the complications of raising kids. It is called to endure the financial strains and the uncertainty about the economy. It is called to endure the medical diagnosis and in sickness and in health. It is called to endure tragedy. True love, it has to be one that endures all of those things. So, and we see that from the story of Christ, because the Bible says that God's plan for salvation and God's plan for humanity even predated his forming the world. Meaning that he knew that we were going to mess it up. And he knew that the only way that he was going to be able to save and restore us was for him to give of himself. And despite that, he said, I am willing to give of myself. My perfect love is enduring enough that I want to demonstrate my love for them by giving of myself. It is an enduring love. I think of the parable of the prodigal son, where the son takes his inheritance before the father dies and essentially says, you know what, Dad? You were debt to me. I want what is owed to me upon your debt. I want it now. He goes and he squanders the inheritance, and he has this moment of realization and says, you know what? Life in my father's house for the servants was better than what I'm experiencing now. So I want to return to my father's house, not to be restored to sonship, but just to be a servant. And he says, I'm going to go back to my father's house. And the moment he makes that decision to go back to his father's house, and he's within sight of his father, he's rehearsing what he's going to say. And in that moment, the father, what does he do? He tucks his cloak in his belt buckle, and he runs to the son. And before the son is able to get a word out, he embraces his son and restores him to sonship. And it is that idea of there's nothing that we can say, there's nothing that we can do that can outrun the love of God. God, we have a God who loves us without end and unconditional. And all it takes for you and for me is to make that initial step to go back to the Father, and we will be bum rushed by the love and grace of God. All it takes is us saying, God, I'm coming back to you, and he runs to us. So God's perfect love is enduring. And the last point is God's perfect love is sacrificial. We're reminded of John 3:16, where it says, God so loved the world that he gave what? His only son, his only begotten son. In the Old Testament reading, we read of the story of Abraham, who also was called to give his son, his only son. And so as they're going and they're walking up to the mountain to make the sacrifice, Isaac, and we read the story and we think of Isaac as like this little kid. Most Bible scholars say that Isaac was probably late teens, early 20s at the time. And so Isaac has this realization that we have the fire, we have the rope, where is the sacrifice? And you can imagine Abraham's heart sinking in that moment, as he knows that the sacrifice is his son, his only son. And so he, acting in faith, says, God himself will provide the sacrifice. And so they go up, and Isaac, realizing that he is going to be sacrificed, willingly allows himself to be placed on the altar. And in that moment, as Abraham is about to make the ultimate sacrifice, God stops him, and he sees a ram caught in the thicket. The reason that God asked Abraham to do that was not because he wanted Abraham's to sacrifice Isaac, by no means. He wanted to foreshadow what he himself would have to do, giving up his own son. But there's a difference, because Abraham was going to do it, but it wasn't out of love. It was out of obedience. It was out of fear of the Lord. But God does and fully acts on what was foreshadowed through Abraham, not out of obedience, not out of obligation, but out of a perfect love, a sacrificial love. He knew that without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. He knew that in order for humanity to be restored, in order for us to be in right relationship with God the Father, there had to be a sacrificial lamb. And that sacrificial lamb was his son, his only son. And so perfect love requires sacrifice. It is a sacrificial love. And we're no doubt the physical pain that Jesus endured on the cross was unimaginable. But I submit to you that the physical, the emotional and spiritual pain that Jesus endured on that cross was so much worse. Why? Because the Bible says that he who knew no sin became sin, so that we would become the righteousness of God. And in that moment, when he became sin, he became what God hated the most. And so he became what his father hated. So much so that in his last breath, he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And in that moment, what he's experiencing is a separation from his father. He became despised in the eyes of his father, so that when God the Father looks at us, he no longer looks at us through the lens of our sins. He looks at us through the lens of our Savior. And he doesn't see our filthy rags. He sees our righteousness. But it was only through and only manifested through the perfect love that was manifested on the cross. So we, this morning, we recognize and we celebrate Valentine's Day, but we celebrate being recipients and participants of the greatest love story that was ever told. We recognize that we are beneficiaries of the love that was a call to action. We recognize that we are beneficiaries of love that is enduring. We also recognize that we are beneficiaries of a sacrificial love. And in response to that perfect love, like Jesus commanded Peter, our only response is to love the Father, but then also to love one another. To love one another with a love that requires action. To love one another with a love that is enduring. To love one another with a sacrificial love. We are called to model that love that was demonstrated for us on the cross to one another. And when we do that, all of humanity will know the perfect love. And they will know a love that knows no bounds. They will know the love of a Father who runs to them. We are called to be vessels by which that love is demonstrated. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for the perfect love story. We are so grateful for the fact that he who knew no sin became sin, that we could become the righteousness of God. We are so grateful for a love that is enduring, a one that is a call to action, but one that is sacrificial. God, we are so grateful to be part of the greatest love story ever told. And in response to that, God, may we love you and love one another. May we, as you instructed Peter, tend to your sheep, love your sheep. May we share the unending love of God with those whom we need at work, and at home, and in our daily interaction. God, may all of humanity learn of your great love. In your name we pray. Amen. 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 And so I invite you to stand for the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father, Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived.
conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He sits at the right hand of the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated as we sing the offertory of the power. Unconscious on the respirator, and God, we pray that your will would be done in that situation. Be with the medical professionals, be with the family in this time. Would you restore her if that's your will, but if not, God, would you prepare the family to know that she'd be restored and healed in eternity with you. God, we pray for the situation in Turkey and Syria. Early estimates are that there's about 22,000 people that were killed in the devastating earthquake. We know that is probably an underestimate. God, we just pray that you would be with the people of Syria. May we as a church united, as a universal church, demonstrate the love that you demonstrated for us, to the people of Turkey and Syria and their government. God, we also lift up and we're reminded that February is an opportunity for us to celebrate the contributions of African Americans and Black Americans to this great country of ours. And God, we recognize that we have so much work to be done to reconcile the pains and the hurts of the past. But we also know that when we are united in you, and when we are recognized that we are all brothers and sisters created by you, that's where true reconciliation occurs. And so this month of February, may we recognize all of the incredible contributions made to this great country, not by just African Americans, Black Americans, but by all Americans, because they are in fact part of the American story. And so we lift up Black History Month, and then God, for the call process. We know that this is in fact your ministry. And so as Pastor Barnes has vocalized or articulated his desire to retire, we know that you have the next shepherd of this congregation already ordained and already identified. And as we as the call committee and we as a congregation take the steps to identify that next person, God, may we do it prayerfully. May we begin to work in the heart of this next pastor and in his family so that he can be ready to shepherd this congregation and take it to the next level and in the next chapter of Holy Cross Story. God, we pray, we lift all these things up in your name, and we pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated for a couple of announcements. The first this is Miss Jane's online Bible study. Thank you. The women's Bible study that has been going strong on Sunday mornings, they're now doing it online at 11 a.m. each Saturday. Feel free to join. If you want any more information, I know Miss Jane had to step out and say. Anybody else that regularly attends? Find the shape of the meeting ideas there. I'm sure that's also available on our social media. Next announcement. LWML Rally at St. Paul Lutheran, March 25th. This is just a save the date. So if you want any additional information, ask Jenny. Anything else? February 26th, celebrate Black History Month. It'll be a great opportunity. I can guarantee you, most Lutheran churches don't look like this in terms of race or ethnic composition. So we're so blessed to have a culturally diverse congregation. And so on February 26th, we will celebrate that. And then a couple more announcements. The first is, last week we introduced these bookmarks This is the 12 characteristics and values that we, as a call committee, identified as wanting or looking for in the next pastor of Holy Cross. We invite you, the bookmarks are out in the narthex. We invite you to take the bookmark, and the purpose of the bookmark is really to serve as a reminder and to encourage you all to pray alongside Holy Cross and pray alongside the call committee, believing that God has already identified the next pastor that's going to serve here at Holy Cross. But if you can grab one, grab a couple, put them in your Bible so that you're reminded of it during devotions, or just put it in your car, that we invite you to pray alongside that. And then the last thing with respect to the call committee. So the part of the call process is that the congregation is invited to nominate individuals that they believe have the calling, after having prayerfully considered it, have the calling to serve as the next pastor. These are individuals that you may know that are ordained in the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod. And so part of the call process is you as a congregation can make nominations. And so we will have these nomination forms in the narthex. If you know of anybody, if there's somebody online that you follow that you think might be a good fit for Holy Cross, go ahead and fill that out. It has to be signed. And you either return it to Holy Cross, and Audrey has volunteered to be the recipient of it, or you can send it directly to the district. But it's pretty self-explanatory. But if you know a pastor who would be a good fit for Holy Cross, this is your opportunity to nominate those individuals. This will be available for 2 weeks. So February 26th will be when the nominations close. And just so you're aware, these nomination forms will be sent to the district. The district president will contact the district president when that pastor is serving and see if they're even open to a call. And then if they are, then that name will be included in the packet of information that gets sent to the call committee. So it's a big undertaking. You might be the one that nominates the next pastor. Who knows? And this is God's ministry, and God has already orchestrated and identified the next pastor. So be willing to think big. If there is a pastor of a Lutheran church in Alaska or Michigan that you know of, Put them down, and we'll see, because it's ultimately a call from God to that person. We are just mere catalysts in sending that. So if you know anybody, the nomination form will be out there. Please refer them to Audrey. And if you have any questions about that process, you can ask me. With that being said, I don't think there's any other announcements. Go. Well, also, today is Super Bowl Sunday. We will keep praying that the Dolphins eventually will be the Super Bowl. Until then, we will take solace in knowing that we are still the only undefeated team in NFL history, and we'll just have to rest our hat on that. But with that being said, enjoy the Super Bowl, and just be the love of Christ out there in the communities. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious upon you. May the Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Thank you.
already.